Now, it was never given to a righteous man, and that means one that's been made righteous for his faith in Christ, because he's been called now to a much higher plane before God, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers. Now, the law is therefore not made for a righteous man, one that's been justified before God. But why is the law given? Why, it's given for the lawless. Thou shalt not kill. It's not given to a child of God who's not murdering anyone, who does not want to hurt but wants to help. That's given to that man yonder that is a murderer at heart. It's given to control a natural man, and that is the purpose of it. It was for fornicators, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjured persons, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. You see, you and I, when we've come to Christ, we now are saved on a different principle, by the grace of God. Now we've been brought into the family of God, and we've been brought to a higher plane to live altogether. Let me give two illustrations of this that I trust might be helpful. Here is a judge on a bench, and it's brought before him a lawbreaker, and you can pick any law that you want that he's broken. Now, he should be sentenced. He should pay a heavy fine, and he should go to prison. Now, the judge says, I have a son that loves this prisoner. I have to condemn him. He's broken the law. Now, my son has agreed to pay the fine. He's a wealthy man. He's agreed to go to prison on behalf of this man. Therefore, the penalty has been paid, and I'm going to take this criminal into my home, and I'm going to treat him as a son of mine. And so he takes that criminal home with him. Now he doesn't talk to him anymore about thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal. He's his son. He's going to talk to him now about how he's to love the members of the family. He's going to talk to him now about how he's to act at the family, how he's to come to the table, how he's to obey the judge's wife, how he is to have part in the family chores and the family duties. You see, he's on an altogether different basis than he ever was before. That's what God has done for the sinner. We're not under law, therefore, but we're beyond that, above that. That law's for that fellow out yonder that is the lawbreaker was given at the beginning to control the old nature, the flesh. Now let me give another one, I think, that reveals this, that should be in the family of God, a family of God where there is faith and love and a good conscience, as we saw last time. This is an illustration that I heard Dr. Ironside give many years ago. Dr. Ironside taught up at the Indian Conference up at Flagstaff. For about 15 years straight, I went up there, and they've invited me every year since then, and I just haven't been able to accept. I've got a bad conscience on that, I tell you, because I'd love to go up there. At one time, when they had the 50th anniversary, I was up there with Dr. Theodore Epp. He was born out there on the reservation among the Hopis. His father was a missionary there. And he was one of the speakers, and Dr. Carl Armading and myself. And we had a wonderful week there, speaking to the Indians as well as others that had come from all over the country. They told us there were members of 35 different Indian tribes that were represented there. Well, one time, Dr. Ironside took with him one of the Indians who had become a Christian up to Oakland, California. Now, they got on the Santa Fe train there in Flagstaff. But when they got to Barstow in California, they changed trains. They got off the train that was going into Los Angeles and waited in the station. and they waited 2 or 3 hours, then got on the train and went to Oakland. Now, while they went to Oakland, this Indian gave his testimony. They were staying in the home of some very dear friends of Dr. Ironside. And so this Indian was invited, among other things, to speak to a young people's group. And this young people's group all got hung up that night on law and grace, as they generally do. And they couldn't distinguish between the two, or the place of the law. And so this Indian asked if he could get up and say something. And he got up and said something like this. He said, "I see that you white folk here are all mixed up on law and grace." He said, "I'd like to tell you a little story." He said, "I came here from Flagstaff, Arizona, on the train. We stopped at Barstow, and we are in the waiting room, and we are waiting there, and I noticed on the walls there, on all of the walls, there's a sign, 'Do not spit on the floor.'" And it was on the inside, it was on the outside. He said, that was the rule there. And he said, "I looked down on the floor," and he said, "it looked like everybody spit on the floor. Nobody paid any attention to the law." And then he says, "We get here to Oakland, and we go to this nice, lovely home. And they tell me to sit down in the living room. And I sit down in the living room. And while I'm waiting for them to come, I look around and I see pretty pictures on the wall, but there's no sign there that says, 'Do not spit on the floor.'" And he says, "I get down on my hands and knees and feel of the rug." And he says, "You know, nobody spits on the floor." He says, "It was law at Barstow. It's grace in the home in which I'm staying." That's the difference, friends. That's the real difference. Under law, man never kept it. He can't measure up to it. He breaks it. But now he's been brought by grace into the family of God. And he's not going out and murder. He's a son of God now. And he ought not to lie, but when he does, he's out of fellowship with God, that's for sure. But anyway, that's the illustration. Now, he says, these things are contrary to sound doctrine, therefore, to put man back under law, because the child of God is in a family where the emphasis should be upon love, upon faith, and a good conscience.